We all back to our camp here. It's the last day of our international ski jumping camp for women. It's live from Lillehammer. And I all hope that you had a great time so far. Earlier today, we showed you some of our strength exercise. I don't know if you are doing anything like that at your own, or exercises like that. But our aim was just to show you how we do it and show you maybe some, and hopefully you might got some new ideas to develop around your exercises. So as you could see, we put in some elements of technique training into the strength training, and then we mixed it up with some motor learning skills as well. And I think this mix makes the training relevant for developing the athletes, and also of course more interesting, as you can work and on the same tasks in the gym that you are challenging with in the hill. So, but for sure, I will recommend for younger girls that are new to strength training, that they should start with the regular exercises. And when it comes to load and repetition, when you are new, I always will recommend that you have less load and many repetition, because your main focus should be on proper lifting technique and having the right movement of the exercise you're doing. And then focusing on firing the glutes and have control over the knee joint. That's really important, I think. And when it comes to the load you should use, is it's always the level of your lifting technique that decides how heavy you can lift. So that's my kind of philosophy when it comes to strength training. And I'm also so happy to introduce to you all Maren Lundby. She will be joining us here on this common session. And she will speak a bit about her experience regarding physical training during the past years. So, Maren, are you here?
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
So, first of all, Maren, I want to congratulate you with a great success in winning the big hill event in Oberstdorf.
I guess you
played an important role for making that event happen.
Yeah, thanks. It was a lot of fun. So it was fun to be in the big hill. And I think all the girls enjoyed it.
Yeah. And to everyone who's listening, if you have any questions for Maren during this session, just either you can raise your hand if you want to ask a question in personal, or you can write it in the chat and we will we will speak about your question. So Maren,
yep.
When it comes to physical training, what is your experience when it comes to strength training versus power training?
For me, I from early on, back in 2009-10, and from then and to 2017, I did a lot of power training with a lot of speed and jumps, and not so heavy lifting. And my experience with that was, After the years, I got some problems, especially with my back and my knees, which made it a bit tricky for me. It was not a big injury, but yeah, I had some small injuries, which was, yeah, I did not feel good after all those years of training with that kind of philosophy. So in 2017, before the winter season, we changed a little bit. We had some heavy lifting, or we had some lifting before that, but mostly we were aiming for the speed of the movement, so really light weights and really trying to do the movement fast. And in 2017, we changed it totally. We did more heavy lifting, more this what is this called? Heavy slow, which yeah. You do the movement really slow, 1, 2, 3, 4 down, 1, 2, 3, 4 up, and really controlling the movements. And it's also, yeah, it made the lifting quite heavy for me. And yeah, after that, I felt less pain in my body. I also got more power in my jumping technique. I did physically, I got better. I jumped higher, and I also felt better and was able to stay away from injuries. So I think from that year, I kind of changed my philosophy about strength training.
Yeah. But what do you see as the biggest benefit that you get from strength training?
It's hard to say, but I think feel that you kind of train the whole body, and I feel a lot more stable and in a better physical condition. And also, yeah, I feel like when you're jumping and also doing the telemarks and at the long distances, it's quite important to have a good strength and to have a good body to make those long distances, because it's a lot of pressure, and I think it's really important to stay away from injuries in those moments too.
Yeah. That's I totally agree with you on that. You said that you had some injuries, but have you had any, or the before this season you had struggled with some pain again? Can you say something about that, and why do you think it's the reason why you struggle with knee pain?
Yeah, before this season I had some, I was diagnosed with jumper's knee, and before this season I'm always aiming to find some new ways of training. So this year I was a bit tired of the strength training, and I wanted to do something else and to do something new to try to get better. And then I decided to do some more track and field training, like more jumps, more speed, more landings, not so much strength training any longer. And from March to August, I did that. I felt really good. I was performing quite good at the tests. But in August, I had some pain in my knee again, and I had to track 3 months without training. So, after experiencing that, I think it was not a good idea to change the training plan because I didn't get better, but yeah, I was at least as good as I was, but I think the time I used on it and what I got back was not so much, and I also got injured, so I think that was a learning process for me, and this year I will turn back to my regular strength training.
Yeah, but this is like you, as you say, you want to improve all the time, so try different things, and that's also important of development.
Yeah, it was motivating, so that's why I did it.
Yeah. Yesterday we had a technique and motor skills training session together with Einar. What is your experience when it comes to that kind of training?
The type of what do you call it?
Technique and motoric.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing of getting good technique, and also.
Can you hear me still?
Yeah.
Ah.
You can take it off, yeah.
I feel like this kind of training was really developing my technique. I got a bigger feeling of what technique is. I could do those exercises in the training with Einar, and also try to focus on the same things in the hill. And then it's much easier to have focus in the hill and to find some small things that you can focus on instead of trying different things in the hill. You can find some small things to focus on with Einar on the technique, and then you can go and try that in the hill. So I can relate the motoric training to the technique and also the jumping. So it made it much easier for me to have a stable technique.
Yeah. So what is your biggest success factor in your ski jumping career?
It's hard to say. I think it's, for me, I had a good team around me. They teach me what was important to jump far. It's the technique and the physique, and also about kind of adjusting that to the
equipment.
The equipment. So that, yeah, you have the you know what to do, and you know what you want to achieve, how to jump, and you also have to adjust the equipment to your way of jumping. And also if you want to do that, and then it's about willing to repeat a lot and willing to learn yourself how to do it, and not just having your coach saying do that, but he can say that, and then you have to translate it to yourself so you can have totally control and focus on yourself, and not just have everybody else telling you what to do. So you have to try to learn and find your own way, I think.
Later today we will have Christian Meyer. He will speak about the relationship between the athlete and the coach, and how important is it for you to have a good relationship between you and your coaches?
It's really, really important, and I think what's great with Christian and Jermund and all the others is that we have one goal, and we're doing it together. So if I make a bad jump, It's not just about me, but we're in it together, and yeah, we can also speak about all things in life, and I think it's important to have a good life and to enjoy yourself in the other part of the life. So I think if you have that kind of, if you can speak with them about everything, you can really manage to perform good results in the ski jumping too, because yeah, the most important is that you are feeling well, and I think that's a great part of what Christian and Jermund are doing.
So this is maybe a tricky question for you, because you achieved so much success, but what is your highlight so far in your career, if it's possible to pick one?
I think the Olympic gold, maybe. It was the first time I won something, and also, which I told you, with the injuries, and in 2017 I changed totally, and it was not in the spring in 2017, it was in maybe in September, October I changed, and it was just months before the Olympics, and at that time things didn't go really well for me, but I changed totally, and yeah, it was the first time I won something, so I think that's the biggest so far for me.
Yeah. When you, I hope you're not ending it in many years, but when you're done with ski jumping, can you see yourself as a coach in ski jumping?
Maybe. I don't know. yeah, I think at least I really enjoy the jumping family and being a part of this community or this those people. So maybe I can be a coach. I don't know. But it's not something I think about right now. But yeah, I think so, maybe. But I don't know if they want me.
Yeah. I guess you will be wanted, Maren. I just talked the other day about these big camps we have yearly, but we haven't had the last years because of the corona, but this Storsamling, where you coach young girls. How do you think that is a important role for the young girls?
Yeah, I think it's really important, because when I was younger, I really look up to you and other girls. When I was about 3 to 4 years, or even 5, I had an older woman who was jumping in the big hill where I lived, and I really looked up to her. And every time she was coming to the small hills to say hello, I was so starstruck, and I think it's, yeah, really important to have role models, and she was definitely that for me. So yeah, I want to experience, or to I want younger girls to feel the same happiness with ski jumping as I did. So I really want to make them feel the happiness.
If we have one tip for the young girls out there, what would that be?
Well, just to have fun and to do what you want to do. I think when I was younger, it was all about having fun, and I really enjoyed when I was making longer jumps, and when I was having fun with my friends in the hill. So it's all about that. And I think I was not thinking about ski jumping as training. I was a lot with my brother at home. We were making jumps with the cross-country skis and jumped a lot in the backyard. And I think that was the most funny thing, and also what made me good at jumping, because yeah, if you can do that 3 hours a day, you get a lot of training, and I think that's really important for younger people, but also for me still, to have that that playing and to enjoy it.
You have always been pretty good at putting in 10 marks on long jumps. How have you been training for that?
Well, at first, my coach, when I was 3 years old, he told me, you have to do 10 marks. So from early on, I always practiced 10 marks. And yeah, after that, it just got normal, I think. And of course, sometimes it's hard when you have long jumps, but yeah, for me, I had a lot of training, and also that in the backyard with cross-country skis and just play and have fun. I think that's maybe more important to have that ski feeling and to be comfortable on the skis.
During this fall, you were out from ski jumping for a period of time, and when you got back, you had like pain in your knees, like jumper's knee. How did you mentally prepare yourself for getting back to ski jumping and putting in a telemark on a long jump? Did you think a lot of pain, or?
To be honest, I did not have any pain when I got back, so it was not a problem for me. But I also practiced on the other leg when I was injured. And yeah, I felt that was harder because I haven't done that before. So I think it's about practicing a lot and having good repetitions in your body, so you can just do what you trained to do.
This is really great words from a great ski jumper. Is there anyone out there that have any question for Maren? You can raise your hand or write in the chat.
Please.
I guess not. Or there it was something. It's from Estella. What do you think is the most important exercise to focus on in strength training?
I am not really that. It's not about which exercise, but it's about doing it right and doing enough per week. So yeah, I'm changing a lot of exercises to, because if your body does one exercise for a really long time, it get used to it. So you have to change and try to get your body to do something new. So I don't have any favorite, but of course there's a lot of squats, both on two legs, on one leg, and yeah, many kind of squat exercises in different ways. Yeah.
How do you come up with this variation in exercises?
Well, I get some tell me what to do, and sometimes I search on the internet on different exercises. There's a lot out there to read about and to see what other people do in other parts of the world with Instagram and Google and every kind of social media. You can find a lot of inspiration if you search for it. So mostly it's the legs, of course.
Yeah, because you're not doing so much upper body strength training?
No, they are just there.
Your arms are just there to hold your balance?
Yeah. But people should not be afraid of that either. So.
Oh, that's true. Anyone else wants have some questions for Maren? Have you done any eccentric strength training?
Yeah, if you know. Actually, I'm doing it right now also because it's good for my knee, my injury, and it's also a great way of having a lot of load without being so if you put a lot of load on a squat it can be some risks in having injuries in your back, because I'm much stronger in my legs than in my back, so but with a eccentric load, you get much more load without having to use your back, for example. So I can get more load on my quadriceps and my hamstring and so on if I do eccentric training. So I think that's good for me, but maybe that's for a bit more for viderekomne or for more experienced people. And also, if you do eccentric training, you have a quite long time of, you have to rest for a long time before the next session with squats or something. So it can be up to 72 hours, which is more than normal strength training, which can be around 48. So you have to be a bit aware in the beginning, I think, or all the time.
There's a question from Nicolas de Sum. At the Olympics in 2018, you looked so strong mentally. It didn't look the same in Lahti. What did you change between Lahti and Korea?
It's hard to say. I talked a lot to the mental coach we had. I really tried to tell him how I felt and how what I did wrong in Lahti. And in Lahti, my task was to be really offensive. I went for it, went all in. And in Lahti, I was not sure what I went all in on. So I used that summer to really focus on my technique. So I just knew that I have to have totally focus and I have to know the technique myself, and then my coach can't tell me what to do. So when I came to Korea, I knew exactly what to do, and I had really prioritized technique training that year, and I wanted to have a strong mental picture on how I should jump. And also I won 7 competitions or something before the Olympics, so that also makes your self-confidence a lot better. I think it's a mixed combination.
There's a question from Virag Vurush. Besides strength training, do you do speed trainings? And how do you improve speed in general?
Last year I did some speed training, but what I experience with doing strength training is that my speed gets better when I do the strength training. So I right now I don't do any speed training apart from playing a bit soccer and just doing other things. I don't train my speed so much. I just focus on being strong, and with that you see that the speed also will come, because you are strong enough to push.
Yeah, there's some. Thank you very much from Nicolas, and thank you from Virag Vorosh. Is there any other questions? If not, I think we will go. We will continue. If there's nothing else you want to add. No. Then thank you very much. Oh, there's a.
Yeah, I actually have a question, Lina.
Yeah, yes. I was like, there's a hand there.
Thank you so much for joining us, Maren. You have been following the sport in many years now. How do you see the female ski jumping develop in the future? In your eyes.
Of course I want to see the ski jumping part develop with having more competitions in big hills, and also having more competitions together with the boys on the big arenas, because I think it's important for us to have a bigger audience, and like this year when a lot of our competitions got cancelled, it makes it really hard for us, because we need to show our faces to the world to get more known and to get more popular for the audience. So I think it's important to be more popular. I think it's funnier to see the jumps in a big hill, and I think it's just important to have more competitions so that people get to know us.
Thank you. I just had to ask, I know you will touch into that in the athlete session later on, but I was curious. I will not follow in the athlete session, so thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, as Per-Erik said, Maren will be joining on the athlete session together with Sarah later today. And Per-Erik, should we announce the winner of today's photo session, photo competition, and thank you again to Maren?
Yes, we can do that. I will share my screen. Thank you so much again, Maren, for joining us. We will announce the winner of today and for the competition this week, actually, Lina. And it's Rachel Huter with this great Corona season picture that is the winner of today and the whole week, actually. So she will get the free spot for hopefully a physical camp, hopefully later this year or next year, here in Norway, Lillehammer. So a big congrats to Rachel for this picture. You can see that is wearing masks, and great team spirit there, I think, Lina.
Yeah, it's a great picture.
Yeah, for sure. And I think should we, we have this digital camp now, but our hope is to soon have a physical camp again, like we had in 2019. And we'll say a little bit about that now in the end, but I would like first to maybe share a video from the camp in 2019. And I just need to share the sound when I show you the presentation here. So I will share my screen again. And we'll look at the highlights from 2019 first.
The best thing here was getting to know how the girls in different countries train. And I really also loved meeting Linnea and Sarah Hendrickson and getting to know how they train.
Yeah, it's been awesome to be here at the camp. One of the most important things is, I think, the social aspect and getting these young ladies involved from different nations and having them live together and start to train together, because these are, you know, people that they'll ultimately compete against, but also build lifelong friendships with.
Attending this training camp in Lillehammer has been a great time. It's been a really cool experience. I think the way that this camp can make women's ski jumping bigger and better is just the connections we're forming with the other countries and the other teams. So we don't feel as alone and secluded when we're in the sport. We have friends that we can go to wherever we're traveling in the world.
It's been really amazing to be at this first camp in Lillehammer for women on an international level with seven countries. All the girls seem like they're having a great time, and that's most important. Best thing about this camp is seeing new friendships among the different countries with the girls.
Have a dream to compete at the Olympics, like anybody else, I think.
My goal and my dream is definitely to make it to the Olympics.
I see. I can't wait until we can meet again. This was a different. Different world than we are living in today. So hopefully we will meet in the fall.
Yeah, I agree, Lina. That's we really, really hope that we soon can invite people to Lillehammer and Norway again for a physical edition. And yeah, we are we'll start planning hopefully for an edition in September. That's right.
Yes.
And hopefully also like in 2019, in connection to the possible COC competitions in Norway. So, yeah, keep in mind if you now start to plan the season that can be possibility to have a training camp and join the Lillehammer International Ski Jumping Camp again in September. We will follow the Corona development closely, of course, and keep you updated regarding that. But it's a goal for us, I think, Lina, to hopefully make it happen.
Yeah. And I want to special say thanks to Sarah for helping me and helping you out on this digital camp. And as you can see, she was also here during the physical camp 2 years ago. So, hey, Sarah.
Hey guys, yeah, it's great looking back at that the camp that we had a year and a half ago, and bringing all those girls together was such a good time. And I know that like connecting with the girls that had been there, that they still use some of the things that they learned. And, you know, that's the point of it, is that we come together, we share the things that we learn from each nation, and then bring it back and teach the younger generations and just keep feeding off of it. So the digital camp is definitely, you know, not the perfect situation, but definitely perfect for what we have to deal with right now. And then we can just bring it back in person, hopefully by the fall, and just keep building off of it every year, because bringing the knowledge together is super, super helpful for everyone involved.
Yeah.
We totally agree, Sarah. Great words there. And thank you also on behalf of the Legacy Center for helping us out at this digital camp as well. So yeah, and we still have some sessions left, but this is the last common session, so it's timely, and I think to also thanks all the participants that are following us this week, and to all speakers for great presentations. So cool to have so many famous names joining us through the week. And also big thanks to your athletes, Lina, for joining us at the physical sessions. So we can see the workouts, and as you know, it's all recorded, so you can also go back and do the session again next week maybe, or during the summer. That's an option. So yeah, and again, a big thanks to Ski Jumping Canada, I have to say, for helping us out with support for this digital edition of the camp. And big thanks also to the Norwegian Ski Federation and to Lina for leading us through this week in a great way. We really look forward to future editions of the camp, and as Sarah says, hope to build this camp as a yearly highlight for female athletes in many years, hopefully, to come.
Yeah, and I have to thank you, Per-Erik, for putting this all technical stuff together. And the Legacy Center, the Norwegian Ski Federation, we couldn't have done this camp without you, or not either the physical camp either. So, and also I want to say thanks to all the input from those who spoke, and also big thanks to my leader class that trust me to share this knowledge. And and I'm overwhelmed by so many participants that wants to hear our story. And again, special thanks to the Canadian Ski Federation and to you, Sarah. It's so great to have you on board on this. So
true. And we all, this first time we do this digital camp, and hopefully last time. But anyway, we still hope for some input from you. So we will send you an evaluation form, I think, tomorrow. So hope to give some, or that you give us some feedback about your experience at the camp. But we are not finished yet. So Lina, should I share just the schedule so you can see what's up soon?
Yep.
The two last sessions.
Yeah, the coaches session. Here you will meet Christian Meyer, who's the head coach in the Norwegian national team for women. And he will talk about what he has experienced from the relationship between the athlete and the coach, and some coaching strategies. And he will also, since he's coaching both genders, I have challenged him to think about some differences between coaching men and women as athletes. And then on the athlete session, you will meet Sarah and Maren. Sarah is, as I said, athletes represent at the FIS, and she will inform you about her work on how to develop this sport in the future. And also Maren has some interesting thoughts and ideas. So to all you athletes out there, you should prepare some good inputs, because you really have a great opportunity to speak out, to reach out to Sarah and Maren, and maybe like your dreams, how you see women's ski jumping develop. It doesn't have to be on the World Cup level. It can be on the Continental Cup, the FIS Cup, or is there anything else that we can do for bringing more women together or girls together? Because I think that's also a big part of this camps. How to include girls from, for example, Latvia, Bulgaria, and how to bring girls together. That's also really important, I think, because I know there's a lot of girls out there that's maybe alone in their team or in the country. So here it's a really great opportunity for you all to speak out.
Great, Lina. And you have also got the links for the Facebook group and the Instagram group. So if you haven't joined us yet, please do that. We will also share information there, I think, regarding hopefully physical camp in the fall. So follow us, and we will keep you updated by email and in social medias. But great.
Eric and Line, this is Nikolai. On behalf of the Canadian ski jumping Canada, I would like to just express the appreciation for what you've done over this 3 days. The day is coming still today, but that's definitely an amazing product that we have seen. And there are our compliments for you to put the efforts together and make this available for the larger ski jumping community. These initiatives are just invaluable. So definitely much appreciation. And we think there is a support well spent for what you've done. And we're looking for this camp to last for a long time and actually be enjoyed and experienced by people through the recordings that you also made. Or maybe inside this group or outside of this group, whichever you suggest later in the communication. But definitely, it's really, really great. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for nice words. Thank you. So, Lina, any final words for Sarah, or should we...
No, thank you guys so much. I mean, you know, this takes a lot of work and effort, and for women ski jumpers, like, we kind of have to start from ground zero, and as opposed to other sports, there's just so much already that's happened in years past, but I feel like we really have to keep pushing and keep working to better our sport, and it takes a lot of work, and a lot of the things can just be like brushed aside, and we can just kind of sit and do things like as they've done in the past, but that's not how things are going to change. So it takes a lot to stand up and to put these programs together, and you know, even though it is digital, it's actually cool because we can access more people because they can't fly to Norway or something like that. And so I think there's a lot of knowledge that can be gained from these digital camps as well. So yeah, thank you guys so much. I mean, this is just an amazing resource, and happy to have girls on board to listen and learn and better the sport and themselves as an athlete and a person. So it's really good stuff.
Thank you, Sarah. And yeah, thank you again for helping us out with this camp, and hopefully also the camps to come. We'll probably ask you again, I guess so.
I will.
Great. So next up, coaches meeting and athletes meetings at 7:30 then. You will soon receive the link for those meetings. So again, thank you for joining us. It's been a great, great, great week, I think.
Yeah. See you later.
Yeah. See you.